Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Good Friday service. Tonight we are going to focus our attention on the cross and the person who willingly put himself on the cross, our Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ, God's one and only Son who came to earth to be our atoning sacrifice. And so we're going to focus on the cross this evening, and the order of worship is in the bulletin, and the songs will go unannounced. It'll be readings of Scripture, again, recounting the story. We will have communion together, and we will remember what Jesus did for us. The call to worship comes to us with these words. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Surely he has borne our infirmities, he has carried our diseases, yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. Will you join me in an opening prayer? O Christ, you have forsaken no one, yet you were forsaken by your closest friends. You committed no crime, yet you were sentenced to a criminal's death, and you did it willingly. Tonight we enter your presence with awe and adoration. On this day, centuries ago, you could have saved life, your life, but you refused to betray the purpose for which you had been born. You came down to this earth to love your heavenly Father and your neighbor as yourself. When that love required you to shoulder a cross, you summoned the strength to bear it. Today, O Christ, as we sing and as we pray about that cross, teach us its meaning once again and help us to take up our cross and follow you from death to life. As I said, we're going to celebrate communion together, and so if you are a guest, you are welcome to come to the table. Anyone who has professed Christ as their Lord and Savior, anyone who is a professing member of a Christian church that proclaims the Bible as the message, true message of God, is welcome to join us at the table. I just want to share one thought that I received today as I was preparing for this service. And it was a message from Pastor Jeffries. And he was talking about the fact that as Jesus was at the trial, and Pilate offered the people, the Jewish people, a prisoner to be released. And he thought, sure, that they would want to release Jesus on this Passover feast that they were celebrating, which was the custom of the Romans to release a prisoner on behalf of the Jewish community. But they cried, Barabbas, Barabbas. Well, Barabbas was in Antonio's cell, and he could hear the people shouting his name. And he was wondering, maybe am I going to be the one released? Because this was common custom. So he heard the people shouting, Barabbas, Barabbas, Barabbas. And then when Pilate asked, what do you want me to do with Jesus? Which Barabbas would not have heard, but he heard the crowds crying, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. So you can imagine that Barabbas all of a sudden was thinking, I'm going to be the one that's crucified. They're going to put me on a cross. And then the jailer comes in and says, Barabbas, you are free to go. You have been released. Now that's us. We are the ones who should have been crucified. We are the ones who should have given our life as a payment for our sins. But Jesus instead took our place. And instead we get the word, you are free. Your penalty has been paid. You are free to live your life. And so remember today, tonight, the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. And we're going to lift high the cross and remember what Jesus accomplished on the cross. Our opening song, Lift High the Cross. Please stand as we sing.
Triumphal entry, Luke 19, verse 28 through 44. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethpage and Bethany at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' say, 'The Lord needs it.' Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They replied, 'The Lord needs it.' They brought it to Jesus, threw the cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to the highest.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' 'I will tell you,' he replied. 'I tell you,' he replied, 'if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out.' And as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace. But now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and your children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another, because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you.
We are blessed because we know the answer to the question of what gives us peace. Where do we find our peace? Where do we find our hope? Where do we find our joy? And that is found in Jesus Christ. But it comes to us only when we confess and acknowledge that we are in need of His love and grace and forgiveness. Will you join me in a prayer of confession? Heavenly Father, as we remember Your Son, our Savior Christ, suffering in Gethsemane, our hearts are filled with shame because we foolishly waste our time in idleness, and we make little to no progress in the Christian life from day to day. We lament that personal desires and lusts for personal satisfaction flourish, and they grow every day. Forgive us for our cruel indifference to the cross day to day. Teach us the good news of Your forgiveness. Help us so that we may go to the cross with You, that we may find forgiveness there in Your sacrifice, that we may receive Your grace, and that we may live anew. Through the blood of Christ and in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Man of Sorrows.
Tenants. He went on to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard, rented it to some farmers, and went away for a long time. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants, so they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. He sent another servant, but that one also they beat and treated shamefully and sent away empty-handed. He sent still a third, and they wounded him and threw him out. Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my son, whom I love. Perhaps they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they talked the matter over. "This is the heir," they said. "Let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? he will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to the others. When the people heard this, they said, may this never be. Jesus looked directly at them and asked, then what is the meaning of what which is written? The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. Everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces, but he on whom it falls will be crushed. The teachers of the law and the chief priests looked away for a way to arrest him immediately, because they knew he had spoken this parable against him, but they were afraid of the people.
Son of God and the widows, Luke 20, verses 40 through Luke 21, verse 4. Then Jesus said to them, why is it said that the Messiah is the son of David? David himself declares in the book of Psalms, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. David calls him Lord. How then can he be his son? While all the people were listening, Jesus said to his disciples, beware of the teachers of the law. They like to walk around in flowing robes and love to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and have the most important seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for a show make lengthy prayers. These men will be punished most severely. As Jesus looked up, he saw the rich putting their gifts to the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small copper coins. Truly, I tell you, he said, this poor woman has put more than all the others. All these people gave their gifts out of their wealth, but she gave out of her poverty, put in all that she had had to live on.
And so tonight we're going to, I know we probably weren't aware of it, but we're going to take an offering for benevolence tonight. And so at this time, we're going to pass the offering plate, and if you would contribute to benevolent causes. the Last Supper. Luke 22, beginning at verse 7, reading through verse 38. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, "Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover." "Where do you want us to prepare for it?" they asked. He replied, "As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters, and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room, all furnished. Make preparations there." They left and found things just as Jesus had told them, and so they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, Jesus and his disciples reclined at the table, and he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks, and he said, "Take this, and he divided it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. He gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to that man who betrays me." They began to question among themselves which of them it might be who would do this. Also a dispute arose among them as to which of them was considered to be greatest. Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors. But you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who is at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who is at the table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you a kingdom, just as my Father conferred one on me, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and sit on the thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail, and when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers." But he replied, "Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death." Jesus answered, "I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny three times that you know me." Then Jesus asked them, "When I sent you without purse, bag, or sandals, did you lack anything?" "Nothing," they answered. He said to them, "But now, if you have a purse, take it, and also a bag. And if you don't have a sword, sell your cloak and buy one. It is written, 'And he was numbered with the transgressors.' And I tell you that this must be fulfilled in me. Yes, what is written about me is reaching its fulfillment." The disciple said, "See, Lord, here are two swords." "That is enough," he replied. And so Jesus celebrated the Passover with his disciples, a Last Supper, before he was going to the cross, before he would suffer. Little did the disciples know what was going to transpire in the coming hours. And Jesus reminds us through Scripture that we are to do this as we remember his sacrifice. And so tonight we will celebrate communion as the body of Christ, and we will remember what Jesus did and how Jesus served his disciples, and how at the Last Supper he took bread. And after he had given thanks, he broke it into pieces. And he gave it to each one of them, and he said, "Do this in remembrance of me." And so tonight, we take the bread and we eat it, remembering what Jesus did for us. At this time, the elders can come forward, and they will pass out the elements. Thank you. take, eat, remember and believe that the body that was broken for us was broken for the complete forgiveness of all our sins. After they had finished the meal, Jesus took the cup of blessing. And again, he offered a prayer of blessing over it, and then he poured it out, and he offered it to his disciples, and he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant, a new covenant which has been poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And so today, tonight, we receive the cup, remembering Jesus shed blood for us. Take, drink, remember and believe that the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ was shed for the complete forgiveness of all our sins.
Jesus prays on the Mount of Olives, Luke 22, verses 39 through 46. Jesus went out as usual to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples followed him. On reaching the place, he said to them, "Pray that you will not fall into temptation." He withdrew about a stone's throw beyond them, knelt down, and prayed, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling on the ground. When he rose from prayer and went back to his disciples, he found them asleep, exhausted from sorrow. "Why are you sleeping?" he asked them. "Get up and pray, so that you will not fall into temptation."
Trial of Jesus, Luke 22, beginning at verse 66 through 23, verse 25. At daybreak, the council of elders of the people, both the chief priests and the teachers of the law, met together, and Jesus was led before them. "If you are the Christ," they said, "tell us." Jesus answered, "If I tell you, you will not believe me, and if I asked you, you would not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the mighty God." They all asked, "Are you then the Son of God?" He replied, "You are right in saying I am." Then they said, "Why do we need any more testimony? We have heard it from his own lips." Then the whole assembly rose and led him off to Pilate, and they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar, and claims to be Christ, a king." So Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to the chief priests and the crowd, "I find no basis for a charge against this man." But they insisted, "He stirs up all the people all over Judea by his teaching. He started it in Galilee and has come all the way here." On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at the time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased because for a long time he had been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform some miracle. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave no answers. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. They dressed him up in an elegant robe, and they sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people. He said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence. I have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us, as you can see. He has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him. With one voice I cried out, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown into prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept on shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore, I will have him punished and then release him." But with loud shouts, they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant them their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for, and he surrendered Jesus to their will.
The crucifixion. As they led him away, they seized Simon from Cyrene, who was on his way in from the country, and put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the barren women in the wombs that never bore and the breasts that have never nursed.' They will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and the hills, 'Cover us.' For if men do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it's dry?" Two other men, both criminals, were also led with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Christ of God, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine, vinegar, and said, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him, "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God?" he said. "Since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise."
Thank you.
Jesus' death and burial. Luke 44, 23, verse 44 through 56. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. For the sun had stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely this was a righteous man." When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breast and went away. But all those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment.
Will you join me in prayer? Father in heaven, we are amazed at the fact that you are willing to give up your one and only Son, to send him to this earth to take our place, to be the perfect sacrifice, the Lamb without blemish. We thank you, Jesus, for willingly coming to earth, for willingly allowing yourself to be put on a cross, to be scoffed at, to be ridiculed, to be punished, to be beaten, to be nailed to a tree, which told the world that you were the worst of sinners, and yet we know that you committed no sin. Pilate and Herod declared that you were innocent, and yet you took on our punishment. Our prayer, Lord, is that tonight, as we remember your sacrifice on the cross, that we would go to the cross with you, that we would place our sins upon your shoulders, that we would acknowledge that it is because of us that you are on the cross, and that we would allow our sinful ways, our sinful self, our fleshly ways, to die with you on the cross, so that we may experience that new life that we look forward to receiving and celebrating this coming Sunday on Easter. But Lord, before we can celebrate that new life, we have to give our old life to you on the cross, so that it may die with you. And so thank you again for being willing to make that sacrifice on our behalf. May we live our life with grateful devotion and ever-growing gratitude each day for what you have done for us. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand to receive the blessing, and then after the blessing, we're going to sing the song, "The Power of the Cross." As we remember Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, the Father's words to us are, "May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God your Father be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen."
Oh,